I'm Dan Frost. I'm the digital, I just said it, learning technology lead in digital new product development at Cambridge Assessment English, which means I look at some of the early stage technology and how we can use it for learners and for teachers. And I'm going to talk about, so this has been billed as using technology for talking, for speaking practice and for speaking confidence, but I'm going to tweak the title a bit, which is the technology taking all of our jobs? Is it going to? What's the likelihood? This stuff is moving quite quickly, so I spoke to someone who just there about an hour ago, and I tweaked the slides to reflect that. And this is one of the areas around technology and language learning that is probably going to be changing every few months. It's a fascinating, fascinating area. So, in a kind of dystopian view of the future, we don't need to learn new languages. We just put something like the Babelfish from The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy in our ear, and there's no need to learn another language because it's all done for you. And you can not only buy things like this. I was talking to someone last week who builds these with kids, like 9, 10-year-olds, where it uses real-time translation. But that's not the whole picture of why people learn language. So what's a more interesting thing is how this kind of technology is going to change how we learn. And what's possible at the moment, what's possible for language...
Can we just turn it up a bit? You can't hear it at the back. Sorry, yeah. It's getting a bit loud.
Okay. So what's possible at the moment, how you evaluate the tools and the apps and the speech systems that are out there for use in the classroom, where the changes are coming from, because this is a really interesting area that most of the innovation isn't coming from within the language learning ecosystem. It's coming from huge companies from outside it. And then we'll look at how we've been playing around with the technology to produce apps and tools that learners might enjoy using as they learn. So we'll quickly look at some things that are available at the moment. So if you go to the App Store or the Play Store and search for things like pronunciation practice or speech practice or language speech practice, there'll be a whole load of apps there. And some of them work well for some learners, some work well for other learners. There's a few conversation bots. These tend to be quite kind of slices of a conversation. They're not free-form. The bot doesn't turn it doesn't introduce turns in the conversation. Something that I heard about an hour or so ago is using Alexa and Google Home using Alexa and Google Home so that the learners use these as a kind of research tool so that they're doing their searches through it. Now, I have heard people think that that's good and bad. It's good because it's a tool that's readily available. You can use it on your phone. You can use the in the browser, you can just click record and it would... And then you can do searches like that. But then there's other people that think that that's going to send the learners down a very specific accent because they're going to be matching the accent that those systems have been trained on. Also at CUP, they did a cool little AR thing, which was a scripted practice. So you'd lift your phone up and you'd see this little character, and then you would follow a script to have a conversation with it. Pronunciation is one that we see quite a few startups working in. I think that's because the technology is easier at the pronunciation level. You take a very specific, very isolated task, you take a very isolated task, and the data is easier to train the models on. So these apps tend to give feedback like this. So it breaks down the phonemes into what the learner got right and what they got wrong. But quite often, these things are based on specific accents. So the way that these systems are built at the moment is that they take millions of hours of speech data and of a particular accent or a particular set of accents, and they train a model on that. And then the learner, the user, is matched against that. So you have to be hitting exactly the right accent. So this one was trained on an American accent, and I failed it every time. I couldn't get the American accent. There's also a kind of question about the correctness of making people follow a specific accent. And what you see with quite a lot of these pronunciation and practice apps is that users kind of hit a bit of a brick wall every now and again. The feedback isn't totally useful to them. So this is a fairly typical comment that I've come across on Facebook and Twitter and places like that, where people can't quite there isn't quite enough to do with the feedback. And the other thing to bear in mind is that you can game them. So I was playing with one of the pronunciation practice apps, and all I had to do was match that specific part of it. So thinking back to the classroom, is this useful? Well, it's not a formal, you know, it's not a high stakes assessment. It's a tool that they can use for their learning. So if they want to muck around and do that and not do the learning, then that's what they'll get out of it. But the tools are there, again, searching on App Store and Play Store, to practice their pronunciation. But I think the teacher and the learners need to be aware that the technology isn't foolproof. It can be fooled quite easily. So in technology terms, we're kind of at this blue screen of death stage, I like to think of it, which is where the technology works up to a point and then something goes and no one's quite sure why. So this is where I'm going to go sort of down under the hood and think about the technical side of it. So let's think about what's going on under the hood in these speech recognition and pronunciation and similar things. So you've got all speech recognition does is got one job, turn sound into words. And sometimes it does it well, and sometimes it does it badly. When it does it well, it'll get all of the words right, and when it does it badly, they're all wrong. The technical way of measuring this is the word error rate. So this one has got a horrific error rate. It got one word right, and it introduced a load of words which weren't in the speech. And then this one got them all correct. So high error rate, bad. Low, sorry, not loud enough, okay. High error rate, bad. Low error rate, good. We took a load of language learner audio data, recordings, and high quality transcripts, and we threw them at Amazon and Google and a bunch of other transcription services. So these are the services that underneath Alexa and Google Home and things like that. And this, I won't name which one this is, because they all perform quite similarly. So at this side it's good, low error rate, at that side it's bad. Most of these commercial systems will say they're around here for a native or a confident or a fluent speaker. You basically got 50% error, which means that you're going to drop half of the words. And that's why the more complicated speech recognition things don't work for certain learners, because if it's dropping every other word, it's not going to be able to create a turn in the sentence. It's not going to be able to follow the concept that you're introducing. There's just not the accuracy there. So, but we'll see in a second who's working on fixing that. So today, there are pronunciation and shorter conversation things. I think the using Alexa and Google Home as tools in the classroom are probably a brilliant idea. There's no such thing as one speech recognition system globally. They all behave slightly differently, and all the big companies and the startups are all working independently to get more data and to improve their systems. And we should keep trying with this, because there's some huge people working on this. So this is sort of stepping outside the language world for a second. So these guys, Baidu Research in China, have got a deep voice unit who are setting out to revolutionize how humans and machines interact with each other. If you do that, you revolutionize how humans interact with each other. DeepMind, I've got an anecdotal story about how this is part of Google, how they took an academic paper on speech generation from academic paper to fully production system in about 9 months. So these things pop up, you know, you see them on the news or whatever, Google's just done this, and it looks effortless. Apparently the team worked tirelessly, so they're putting huge amounts of effort into improving this technology. So even though it can be a bit patchy and spotty, there's tons of stuff happening. And there's some interesting people who you wouldn't expect. Spotify, the music streaming service, bought the Echo Nest about 10 years ago, and this was leaked recently on Twitter, that they appear to be building their own speech recognition system, which makes sense when you think about, you've got a ton of audio data scientist guys here, people who understand how to analyze audio, pointing them at speech, having looked at music for 10 years, is going to be pretty straightforward. But on top of this, you've got lots of startups who are taking very thin slices of the problem. They might be looking at how to get enough like Norwegian speaker data about a particular type of word or another type. So all of these gaps are being filled in over time. So looking at what was out there and what other people have got, and looking at what the trends were, we thought, what can we build and what would be useful? And so I arrived yesterday and I had a sort of an idea about what, how I'd present this. But I think this is more of a question. It's like, what should we build or what could we build? So you can see the Cambridge Beta link there. That's worth going to and keeping an eye on, because this stuff is like fresh out of the lab. This isn't stable. We're not about to release it, but it is working in a kind of proof of concept way. So I'll show you what we're thinking. So we thought, what if you can have this digital voice where you could, where in, maybe in the future, you would just learn straight from it. You would just, it would say, hi, what language do you want to learn? And it would just take off from there. It would have to pick up all about you, what you want to learn. It would have to do all the different types of teaching, and it would have to be a hell of a lot more clever than they can do at the moment. So we brought it back and thought, what can we do at the moment? And we started looking at what other people are doing with the kind of conversational chatbots. And they weren't, we couldn't really see a meaningful use for them. They just seemed to be a bit kind of toy. And I'm not sure if we've got anything a bit more than toy, but it seems to be kind of the beginning of something. So the idea was that you would open up the app, and this is again kind of working in the lab at the moment. You open up the app and it says, hi, what did you do last weekend? We've got a kind of vocabulary bingo. Now, this could be linked to the course that you're studying, a particular set of words, like time or motion. And so you give a response to that, and then it pings up the ones that you got right and asks you a follow-up question. The great thing about this is that we don't care about the error rate. We don't care whether you said a sentence or got everything right. We're just looking out for particular words. So we're kind of cheating around the flaws in the technology. And then we're giving some kind of feedback. So at the moment, we're looking at some academic research that looks at indicating the CFR level by their vowel consistency. So this is pulling in some of the more cutting edge research. And we're also looking at how other people are giving feedback and what's useful. But this is the sort of the early stage where we have to experiment, try something, realize we went slightly in the wrong direction, put it in the hands of learners and teachers and go, it's not quite useful. So. Will robots take our jobs? Probably not, soon, so that's good. But there is a big question about how best to use the technology. So I think playing with the apps available in the App Store, the Google Home, Alexa, following what we're finding on beta and helping us experiment and create new tools and apps and tools is the way forward. So that's where we are.